name is Vasyl. I'm working self-serve for almost 11 years, 4 years as an architect. So today I'm going to share my experience. Working with one US company that decided at some point that they are going to move to event-driven architecture. So there were some challenges. We can talk about the reasoning behind such move and what to expect from such changes. So let's plan for, I would say, 30 to 40 minutes and most of questions at the very end. However, during the presentation, I will stop several times and will let you ask some ongoing questions. Okay, let's start with with the agenda. So first, let's talk about the problem, the drivers that were influencing our decisions, and the solution. Then we will talk why we choose Kafka. There are some existing difficulties and problems. We will talk about that, and also what else do we expect to be implemented to have a full solution. Use case. Let's talk about some historical reasons. So our customer had a legacy monolith application. They were developing that probably from mid-2000s, and at some point it became hard to add functionality, to maintain that. The cost increased because of I would say DevOps work as well, because everything was manual, no Kubernetes, no like automatic deployment, and so on and so forth. So they decided, as many companies, to move into microservices. That was a trend. Everyone liked microservices, and truly speaking, microservices solve a lot of problems that have monolithic architecture. So that's deployment is easier, cost is less, it's easier to extend. However, microservices architecture also have some drawbacks and some, I would say, potential pitfalls when you start evolving your microservice architecture. And that's exactly what happened. So during initial phase, they took a lot of functionality out of monolith. They used a pattern called anti-corruption layer. That's one microservice that is sitting between microservice stack and legacy application, and all like bad design is hidden behind that anti-corruption layer, and all good design is in microservice stack. But at that time it was like few teams, maybe three teams, that were working on different parts of that microservice architecture. And so at some point they started to grow, and from year to year, microservice count was increasing. And the worst thing that may happen with that is the coupling started to increasing like very quickly. What that mean is their nice, pretty microservice architecture started looking as so-called distributed monolith. So what that mean is, in fact, you have microservices deployed in some containers, but they are coupled so hugely that it's hard to extend something, or if some microservice is down, then half of the system is down. So basically, that's a problem that they try to solve. And so here we have a list of what items caused review of the architecture. And so first is that existing microservice architecture need to be extended, and extended a lot, because they were adding more and more teams to their projects. So microservice count is growing very fast. It becomes hard to track the dependencies. Legacy monoliths still in place because they were not able to completely move out of monolith. So need to take that into account as well. Yeah, and that anti-corruption layer that I mentioned before, it became a bottleneck, because there are some business entities in their domain that persisted in the legacy application. That's why every part of a microservice cluster need to reach out to anti-corruption microservice via API and ask for some data from the legacy system. So obviously that's a bottleneck. Yeah, and here I added the slide. So we are using a utility tool called Datadog. So that's some log aggregator and also APM monitoring system. And so here is how our microservices map looks like. That's only a part. I have not included the whole map, but you can see that connections are like almost every service connected with few other services, and that's not good. And here are the drivers. So what we expect from our system in future, that's kind of future state. So high extendability, we want to our system to be extended as much as we want. High scalability, since customer wants to move to other markets, not only USA. So we are going to expect more users to be using our system, more requests coming. That's why we need to scale horizontally. And high availability, so in case if some microservice dies, so the system should work. Fault tolerance, so that's connected with high availability, and low coupling, that just because if we want to take out something from our system, we can do that easily, not by changing code base for half of microservices and system. Okay, so maybe let's pause here before we go into solutions. So do you have any questions at this point?
I have one question. You told that microservices were connected to each other.
Yep.
What does it mean? Does it mean that they are communicated with each other by HTTP or what? Or
common
database?
You are correct.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so good question. The coupling was done by using REST API calls. So that was HTTP calls. Okay, so let's move on. Here is our diagram. What we have, so that's like anonymized version. I tried to simplify it, so I'm not showing any real microservice names here, but the diagram looks like that. I mean, the real one. So we have some legacy monolith application, legacy database, and this red bar is anti-corruption layer. That's basically an application that sits on top of legacy database and provides some REST APIs to other microservices. And we have a bunch of microservices, each with own small database. And for example, as you see here, microservice one ask for some data from legacy, and microservice 5 and microservice 3 relies on APIs that provide microservice 1, and also microservice 1 ask for something from microservice 2. So everything is tightly coupled. So here is what we came up with. So at some point, and idea was coming from the customer. Basically, they have their own architecture team. And so they were investigating the possible solutions, what can we change? And the idea was, let's try to use event-driven architecture in our case. So now it looks like this. So still, anti-corruption layer is in place. At some point, we may dispose that. So at that time, our architecture will be even cleaner. But now, legacy database stores some data that needed for all other microservices. That's why we decided to use CDC, that stands for Change Data Capture. That's technology when so when any record changes in database, some applications that monitors that database takes that record and produce an event into message bus. So in our case, that is Kafka, and there is such a tool called Debezium. So Debezium, that's change data capture plugin for Kafka. Yeah, so all data from all needed data from legacy database are streamed into Kafka by this Debezium. And also every microservice is connected to Kafka cluster, which means that microservice can be either producer or consumer. In case if it needs some data, it consumes events from appropriate topics. And in case if it just contains some data that may be needed by other microservices, so in that case, that's a producer. And we have a legend here, so you can see that microservice 2 is only producing some data. And if we go back, we can see that in our like previous state, microservice 2 was not expecting any data from anywhere. So it just provided some data to microservice 1 and microservice 3. So that's how it's producer. So if we talk about real life use cases, that may be some data importer, or it may listen to some third-party APIs and produce events into our system. So there are a lot of cases. Yeah, and for example, microservice 3, so it just consumes some data from Kafka. Okay, so let's talk about benefits of event-driven architecture in general. So it's easy to extend and scale. Basically, if we need to add something on top of this, let's say microservice 6. So we just need to decide which data are needed for that microservice, create an application, deploy that, and create either consumer threads or producer threads in the scope of that application, and that's it. So no other parts of system will be affected immediately. However, sometimes if you want to add some functionality in your system that may be used in existing microservices, so you add, let's say, microservice 6, it consumes some data, but it also produces some new data that, let's say, will be used in microservice 5. So that means that you go into microservice 5 and just add one more consumer thread there. And that's it. So like changes are relatively easy. yeah, loose coupling. So if you take off any microservice from here, all others will be still working. However, the data may be not accurate for some functionality because obviously microservice, let's say microservice 2 is producing some data. So that means that if we shut down microservice 2, some functionality will not contain the latest data set. But the overall system will still be functioning. Yeah, and asynchronous communication. So that means that instead of using REST API, which is from the development perspective, we can say that we are doing asynchronous calls, right? Because that is implemented on the multi-threading level. However, if we are talking about architecture in general, so HTTP is synchronous approach, because if you send a request, you need to get a response and you wait for it. In case of event-driven architecture, you can produce some event into your message bus, and consumer application may consume it immediately, may consume it based on some schedule, so that does not matter. Producer need to produce data, consumer need to consume data at some point.
Vasyl, we have one question, I guess, from
Maxim. Yeah, sure.
So as far as I can see, really so many benefits from this event-driven architecture, kind of loose coupling, asynchronous communication, etc. It brings so many advantages as well as, from my point of view, disadvantages. I just wanna ask you, in case of need of some kind of debugging or troubleshooting, how easy was it to really find the right place, who actually the right place where the issue is?
Okay, yeah, good question. So that's not always easy to debug. Mm-hmm. In our case, we totally rely on log aggregator. Having some logging standard in place, plus you should pay attention that development teams are following that standard, plus have that Datadog setup for every application in your stack. So in total, that gives us ability to debug pretty everything that we need. But I agree, so that's maybe main disadvantage of this approach, mm-hmm. is
maintainability, I guess.
Well, that's also, but the complexity is a lot. So we have more complexity in our system with this approach. We have a lot of consumers, a lot of producers, a lot of tooling that we need to have that deployed, build, deployed, and as Maxim mentioned, debugged. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maintainability, that's like a result of high complexity, so you need to maintain all of that.
We had even kind of less complex system, and we had really huge time and efforts to find the issue. And just I wanted to understand, maybe you have kind of silver bullet to fix this issue, at least from your experience, but seems like you have also some difficulties to debug and troubleshooting. Yeah,
you're right.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so let's continue. And now some details. So why Kafka? Basically, we had maybe some influence on the final decision, but not very much. I mean, soft serve team. because investigation was done by customers architecture team. However, on the later stages of this investigation, so I was involved into that, and so the idea why to use Kafka and not something else was just because Kafka, it's not just a message bus, it's an event streaming platform. And what event streaming means is you will be able to like easy to maintain your scaling easier in future. So that's like one of main advantages of Kafka. Somehow I put that on the last place, but scalability was like our main driver. And also, so what Kafka provides to us is real-time processing. Real-time means that when you have some event raised in system, then all consumers that are expecting that event to appear, they will start consuming that immediately. Kafka also provides by its internal design and architecture, so that's a high durable and high throughput system. Here we have some architecture diagrams that shows what Kafka consists of. So we have a Kafka cluster, and we have some related, related services. So Kafka producers and Kafka consumers, that's applications that provide data and consume data. Also, Kafka Connect, I was mentioning before the Debezium. So basically, Debezium, it's a plugin for Kafka Connect. That's an application that is listening to any changes in the source databases and produce data into Kafka cluster. By the way, the implementation for each database type, so it's separate. Internal implementation, how to get the changes in SQL Server, for example, is totally different from how it works for MySQL or Postgres. So that's something that always need to keep in mind. So that's Kafka Connect source. Source mean from source into Kafka, and Sync Connect, that's if you have some topics in Kafka that you would like to persist in some target database, you can have a sync connector, which will be kind of ETL, extract, transform, and load process. So all events from topic will be saved into target database. And some additions to Kafka, so Kafka Streams APIs, and KSQL. We are not using Kafka Streams API, so I can't tell much about that, but KSQL, that's something that we are going to use in future, and I'll talk in details about that later. So in two words, it's basically ability to combine events from different Kafka topics. Okay, and talking about scalability, so how does Kafka scale so well? The main point here is partitioning. So what partition is, that's a part of topic where we store events with some key set, let's call it that way. So in Kafka, every event has key and value. And we can always set partition count for topic to 1. And basically, every event will be stored into single partition, no matter what key it have. But if we divide a topic into, let's say, four partitions, as in this example, so that means that some events with one subset of keys will be stored in partition zero, events with another subset of keys will be stored in partition one, and so on. And that will mean that we can scale our consumer application, and when it's scaled, we call that consumer group. So technically, every consumer here is a separate application, maybe not application, but separate instance of the same application, if we talk about containers. In this case, Kafka provides ability for consumer group to contain as much consumers as topic contained the partitions. So consumer one will be consuming only events from partition zero, consumer two from partition one, and so on. And in case if consumer group can, if consumer group contains less than less count of consumers and partitions, so several partitions can be assigned to one consumer. So why is it working in this way? One of main parts of event processing is event order. And if we would like to maintain event order, that means that we will need to consume events for the same entity in the scope of single application. So if we don't have that, that means that, let's say we have two events that come from one entity somewhere in the system. And by saying the same entity, I mean the key. The key should be the same. So in case if we just put everything into single storage, and then lot of consumer applications just connect to that storage and grab the first events that they can. So that means that, for example, consumer one can process event for that key, earlier event, later than consumer two. Event order will be not maintained in this case. Yeah, so...
Vasyl, we have one question in the chat.
Yeah, sure. Okay, let me open chat. Yeah, so Kafka itself does not give such ability, but there is a good tool called Owl, like K and Owl. So that's some, I would say, nice UI. Maybe not always nice because it's down sometimes in our case, but it provides possibility to look through all your topics, all your consumer groups that are connected to those topics, and see like which consumer is connected to which topic. Let me just go back. Yeah, so if you we have this Kafka Streams API, so it also utilizes this APIs. That's how it works. Okay, Ahmed, did I answer the question?
Yeah, thank you very much, Vasyl. Because for me, always this event-driven architecture, the main problem was it how to know who's consumed the event. Otherwise, we will back to the same question asked by Maxim about maintainability.
Yep.
Like, we cannot know who consumed it, because especially when I face this issue a lot, when especially the architecture group changes and no one knows about how the application is architected and who listened to what. And we come to the same problem, like, okay, like you are firing some event and you don't know who is event, who doing this stuff, who's listening to it, and where the bug comes from.
Yeah, I see.
So That's why I asked especially about that. Does like Kafka have solution for this problem? Like, because the first situation that we need to search on who consumed this event and how many times he it's consumed it, because this is always the main problem. Like he can the either the service consumed it too much or too low, or like how much time this service consumed the event, basically, like what I'm trying to say.
Okay, I see. So in case if you need to see like which application is consuming events from some particular topic, so then Kavl can help you. You can go there and just click on the topic you are interested in, and there is a tab called consumer groups, and you can see like what consumer groups are listening to that topic. However, just to add to this, and basically we had this problem in our system, consumer groups should always follow some standard. Otherwise, you won't be able to match the consumer group name to some real application deployed somewhere in Kubernetes. So if you called consumer group something like dev test, blah, 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 some like unfamiliar people won't know what is that, what is the application. And technically, like from the developer's perspective, you can set this consumer group inside your application to whatever you want. So that does not necessarily the same as your application name. Yeah, and if you need like more details regarding event consuming time and maybe some profiling, so for this case we are using Datadog, which helps to determine those timings based on some logs. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Vasyl.
And I guess Antonina wanted to say something.
All right, thanks. So I wanted to ask about the DevOps part. So whether this whole solution was developed in the cloud, and wondering if Kafka was like used as managed service, or like you took part in, yeah, basically configuring it, the parameters, for example, this number of consumers and producers and partitioning.
Yeah, good question. So let's start from the DevOps part. Since we are using AWS, so decision was made to use MSK. So that's managed Kafka solution from Amazon. Also we have some Confluence schema registry. So we will talk a little bit later about schema registry, but that's something to add to MSK, and that's not managed by Amazon. So we have like our own repository. DevOps are responsible for maintaining that repository and deploying it. And if you talk about topics and some scaling, assigning consumer groups and so on, so that's, I believe, the basis for that is in Terraform. However, the configuration, every team provides own configuration in own repository. Let's say if you want to deploy some Kafka consumer, there is a documentation from DevOps saying what you need to add to your repository, which config files for this to work in existing environment.
Great, thanks.
Okay, let's move on. Yeah, problems. That's my favorite one. So let's talk a little bit about schema registry. So what is that? When you publish some event into Kafka topic, of course you have possibility to publish anything that you want, but in most cases it won't work because producer and consumer should have some kind of contract, as you have for REST APIs, right? So you define some API, there are some tools that use, let's say, Swagger, that used for API definition. And that's how your REST client know how to call your APIs. Same thing here. If you publish some event with just random data set, so maybe somebody will know how to consume that, but that is not standardized, right? And some unfamiliar developer will come and he won't know how to implement consumer. So for that reason, we have schema registry. So every event should have some schema. There are different types of schemas built into Kafka. Basically, there are three default schema types. First is Avro, and we are using Avro. It's more like JSON-based, but with some capabilities of binary serialization and deserialization. Also, we have a simple JSON format. And the third one is protobuf. That's more like binary format. However, the schemas also are, I can say for sure, it's either YAML or JSON, but it has some structure. So I think that like the question what to use, Avro or protobuf or JSON, that's a topic for like completely separate discussion. We can talk about that for hours, and still that's like a holy war question. Every type has some advantages and disadvantages. But let's just concentrate on Avro because we are using that. So for Avro, we have so-called compatibility mode thing. So what that mean is sometimes you want to change your event schema, right? So time passes and you see that you need one more field in this event and how to do that properly. So if you just go ahead and add field, what that mean is all your producers now should produce that field, right? So if you're just adding mandatory field, you need to, before you deploy this new schema into schema registry, you need to change all your producer applications. And that's impact on CI/CD process. Same thing if you have some outdated fields, right? So you have an event with 30 fields, and at some point you were using all of that. But now time changes, maybe part of that object moved to different domain at all. It has some own event in Kafka, and you just want to clean up your events and remove all those obsolete fields. That means that your consumers also need to be changed, right? Because you may have a lot of consumers in your system that expect those fields to be there. And so there are, to manage this, there are some compatibility modes. I can call that forward compatibility, backward compatibility, and full compatibility. So basically, we decided to go with full compatibility. What does that mean from CI/CD perspective is every time when you change something in your schema, no change, no immediate changes to infrastructure should be done. So all existing consumers and producers will still work. How it's achieved, full compatibility means that you can only add or delete optional fields. You cannot add mandatory field, you cannot delete mandatory field. Yeah, but that not always working. And so basically that's a general approach for every architecture decision. You need to do some trade-off. There is no ideal solution whatsoever. So that's why we trade our stability of our environment for some problems during breaking changes. And by saying breaking changes, I mean when you need to add some mandatory field, for example, into your schema. So that's a breaking change. There are several tactics how to handle such cases. We went with a tactic for topic versioning. That means that all topic still stays without breaking changes, and we just create the same topic, just adding some suffix v2 to that topic, and all new applications that need to consume from that new topic, so we connect to those two new topics. Yeah, but there might be some other solutions as well. Yeah, so any questions at this point regarding the Kafka schema registry? Okay, let's move to the second point, error handling. Yeah, so there might be different approaches to error handling in Kafka. And I put here like two approaches that we use for different cases in our system. So first is log and proceed approach. What that mean is, when you produce or consume, maybe consume is better example, when you try to consume some event and something happens, maybe you don't have a logic for some edge case in your consumer, or maybe the data that you received with event are not produced well, right? So there are some flaw in data. So in this case, we just log an error and proceed with the next events. So what is good with this approach is we are not terminating event processing, and we're still doing real-time processing. What's bad, if you want to review the data that came with that event, that's totally manual process. You should, somebody from your team should go to log aggregator or navigate to some log files in the file storage, find that log, see what data were causing that problem, and maybe manually react to that. Not always working, but there are some cases, for example, for data pipelines, where it works well. Yeah, and the second one is retry and terminate approach. Good example here is when you consume some event and data from that event, so you need to send that via REST APIs into some third-party system. Sometimes third-party system may be down, or maybe you are experiencing some problems with your network. So what that will mean is you consume event, and when you're trying to send that via REST API, it fails. So you definitely need to have some retry policy in place. And in case if some amount of retries were not successful, you just terminate and wait until somebody, either from DevOps team or maybe from development team, take a look and see what's the problem and maybe fix the problem. Yeah, so we had such case for several times, and it working, I would say it working well for some edge cases.
Have question in the chat?
Yeah, sure. Oh, dead letter Q. Okay, I was going to talk about that a little bit later, but yeah. So dead letter Q is also a good approach for error handling. However, we don't have that implemented at this point. And unfortunately, Kafka does not provide native support for dead letter queues. And of course, dead letter queue have some problems that we will talk about a bit later. Yeah, but dead letter queue is also approach to error handling. Thank you, Vadim. Okay, how much time do we have? Okay, not really much, but I'll try to speed up. The third point, message delivery strategy. There are basically three approaches to this, at least once, at most once, and exactly once. We went with at least once approach, and just because the implementation for this approach is a lot easier than exactly once. So in my opinion, exactly once delivery is what is like ideal case, but I won't go into details of implementation, but just trust me, that's really complex solution. So if you want to deliver your event exactly once. So if we go with at least once approach, the prerequisite for using it is all your consumers need to be idempotent. So what that mean is, in case if you already consumed some event, but some, let's say, error happened at the very end before you committed your offset in Kafka topic, and your consumer is forced to reconsume that event once more, that will mean that the state will be maintained, right? So your consumer won't change the state of data. Data will be just overwritten with the same values. Yeah, and here I have some details about that at least one semantics. So let's take a look at this sequence diagram. We have producer here, and here is, so the example here is about the, it's based on outbox pattern. So what outbox pattern mean is, you want every event to be produced in some kind of transaction. And in case if you have something happening in your system, and so you are saving some data in the database, and you also want to produce an event in this particular place. So you save some data, you produce an event. However, you save data into database and you are producing event into Kafka. So database has own transaction and Kafka works separately. So what that mean is there might be a situation when you save the data in your database and your producer failed to produce event. So you have data inconsistency and that's bad. As far as I remember, that's called SAGA pattern to phase commit. But I would not say that it's an easy implementation. And there is another pattern. It's called outbox pattern. And that's, in my opinion, easier for our case. So the idea here is you save your data in the database and you save also event record into your database. And that's wrapped into single transaction. And then you have outbox application that is monitoring that event records table in your own database. And as soon as this outbox application sees that there is new records there, it just takes that record and produce the data into Kafka and deletes that record. So like we have two pieces, but every piece is done in the scope of one transaction. And that's exactly what I tried to output here. So we have transaction open, data save and create outbox records, and transaction close. And same thing here, we poll for outbox record. And in case there is one, we produce an event and delete outbox record. Again, I haven't shown that here, but that's wrapped into single transaction. Yeah, so that's producer message delivery guarantees. And if we are talking about change data capture, so delivery is guaranteed by the CDC provider. So we just rely on Debezium implementation to guarantee the event delivery. And about consumers. So in our case, we are following at least once, and that means that we read event batch. And in case if no errors, so we commit the offset, what that means is every Kafka topic have some integer offset for every event. And let's say you pull the batch of events starting from offset 100 and ending in offset 200. So when you process all events, you need to commit that latest offset of the events that you consume. So that will be 200. And Kafka stores that state for every consumer. So Kafka knows which offset was consumed the latest by each consumer. But in case if we are trying to consume batch and there are some errors or one error, so we abort the whole operation, our current offset stays the same. And in the next iteration, consumer will try to consume the same batch. So event, some events may be consumed more than once, but that's okay since we are consuming that in idempotent manner.
Oh, still, we have one more question in the chat.
Yeah, I see. Talking about monolith, yes, of course, that's our target. But I would say that's like midterm, maybe. Maybe in 2 years. Yeah, so monolith is always a pain point for our customer because really there are no good documentation for that monolith, and it's hard to maintain, hard to support. Yeah, so but there are always something that has a higher priority than totally dropping that monolith, so that's a problem. And if we are talking about Debezium, so currently we are using that not only for legacy database, but also for some like microservice databases. So what is the use case here is if you have some table in your database that has exactly same data structures that you are going to use in other microservices. Let's say you have a table that contains everything that other microservice needs. So it's a lot easier to just add one more Kafka connector that will pull data from that table and put that into Kafka. That's why we still be using both approaches. And outbox pattern is good when you have some complex event which contains different entities and it's not mapped to the single table in the database. Okay, let's move to the future improvements. So as we talked about, to support better maintainability, so we need to have the DLQ because current error handling is, I would say, more manual than automatic, and DLQ will let us do that in automated manner. However, DLQ, so this approach has one drawback, which we currently still thinking how to resolve that. It's order of events. So I'm pretty sure there is a solution, but unfortunately we haven't found that yet. But as soon as we will solve the problem how to put events into DLQ and still maintain the event order, so then we will have that in place. Yeah, and talking about performance, KSQL, that's really cool thing. And unfortunately, MSK does not provide that ability. So in order to use KSQL, we need to move to Confluent Cloud. And maybe that will be done in like nearby future. KSQL is kind of query language for Kafka. What that mean is you have, let's say, five topics, but your application need the data from, let's say, three of five. So what you do normally, you have three consumers, and then you somehow combine the data, maybe by using API, additional API calls, maybe by having some, temporary storage, and you update the temporary storage. But or maybe you add one more producer that will collect the exactly needed structure for your consumer. But again, all of that is some additional things in your infrastructure. What KSQL does is it lets your consumer to query other topics. So whenever you have some event raised in your system, you can do one more call to Kafka specifying some query and you will get your data back. So really good performance improvement for infrastructure. Yeah, and efficiency, we were talking about that maybe we can use some sync connectors. So what that mean is you don't need to have consumer applications for some cases, right? So you already have everything in Kafka and you need exactly same data structure to be stored in some database. So what you need, you need to create sync connector, which will write data into database, and that's it. Okay, I think that's all. We are almost in time.